me.
Thank you, Suparnaa. You're welcome.
Wow, you have a beautiful office here.
Yes, quite cluttered, I think, but you'll notice that everything has a particular place. And I like to think that the office reflects my mind. There's a lot happening in my head.
Everything is organized. While well, there is everything.
Yeah,
but
everything is hopefully in its proper place.
Everything in its place.
And
place
I'm also OCD, you know, so if something gets moved even an inch, I can tell.
So please relax for the next 30 minutes.
Yeah,
we can fix everything back.
In fact, the housekeeping staff are instructed not to clean this until I'm in the office.
Okay, so you can look in the camera and say hi. All right, Samar. I'll start with your professional side, of course. You've been heading the marketing for the UB Group for some time now. And we all know, for the wrong reasons, UB has been in the news. How would you handle a situation, especially with the people that are working for you, when there is so much bad blood outside in the public domain, as far as the company is concerned?
Well, first to clarify, I head marketing for United Breweries Limited. There is no UB Group anymore. And even when there was a UB Group, there was no head of marketing for the group as such. The group was under a group chairman, but they were all individual companies. So I head marketing for the beer business, which is United Breweries Limited. Having said that, the Kingfisher brand is the most powerful and most well recognized brand from the erstwhile UB Group. So there was a lot of speculation and conjecture in terms of the impact on the Kingfisher brand, and I must say that when the airlines was functional, it definitely had a very positive impact on the beer business itself. In terms of, one has to admit that the airlines were perhaps the finest flying experience in the sky,
right.
And it was premium, it was aspirational, just like the Kingfisher beer brand.
But it didn't survive, and there were a lot of families that were associated with being employees of that particular brand.
I think people have always differentiated between the two, and just because the airline is not operational anymore, they continue to drink and love our beer brand. We are totally unscathed by any negative narrative that may have
occurred. It's interesting because you as a person are a teetotaler. You never drink. Right, that's what I've known of you, and here you are, talking about Kingfisher brand as being, one of the most lauded brands as far as beer is concerned. The other aspect of you is, I know, I would believe, because I've known you for a while and I've seen what your posts on social media are all about, and you as an individual as well, you come across as a feminist. You are somebody who is there for the bigger cause, right? And still, with your professional work, there is a certain amount of objectification when brands like Kingfisher are promoted. How do you handle that?
Okay, so I'll answer your first question. Yes, I am a teetotaler. I don't smoke or drink. But in Hindi, there's a saying, halwai apni mithai khud. So having said that, I do taste our beers and competition beers as and when they get launched. My job is to get others to drink, not necessarily to drink myself. And hopefully I'm doing a good job on that one. The second question, in terms of me being a feminist, I think I always have stood, I find it very easy to do the right thing. I've always stood for equality. I've always stood for equal opportunity. In fact, when I was at Spencer's, 2/3 of our customers were women, because we were largely a fruit and grocery retailer. My marketing team, I ensured 2/3 were female, because we were able to understand the consumer better. So it was also sort of a professional, practical decision. Here in our office on the third floor, you've seen 50% of the employees here are women. I have a 40-50% gender diversity sort of ratio in our team. I believe women bring a certain skill set and a certain emotional quotient to working that is different from what men bring. I'm not saying better or worse, I just think it's different. And I think even within my family, we have one daughter, and I've brought her up in a way that is no different from what I would bring up a boy.
We're going to come to that conversation.
Okay. We'll come to that. Your third question was in terms of objectification. See, globally, the beer business is, I would say, 70%
of beer consumers are males and 30% are females. In India, it's 99% male. So it's a very brotherhood, bonding, camaraderie sort of culture. But we are very careful not to propagate that typical Silicon Valley bro culture, or what in England is called the lad culture. Alcohol companies in India, in any case, are a soft target. You know, with responsible drinking, with drink and drive initiatives, our CSR initiatives. I think the brand tonality has always been that of inclusion. It's been democratic. It has been gender neutral. And it's always been about men and women above the legal drinking age having a great time together. We have never talked about drink this beer and get the girl. Drink this beer and you will be more attractive to the opposite gender, you know, getting out of control. So it's been very easy for us. The brand tonality is gender neutral. It's about fun. It's about bonding. It's about camaraderie. And, you know, sort of men and women having a great time together.
But one would look at the calendar, say, for instance, and immediately think there is objectification of women there.
There's legacy for sure. There are very limited number of calendars that are printed because they are part of the chairman's mailing list. Fortunately for us, I think we produce the calendar and shoot it in an extremely aesthetic manner, you know, in locations overseas. There's been consistency of quality. It is never cheap or sleazy. It is you know, aspirational, desirable, etc. But more than that, it's not the calendar itself, it's everything that we do around the calendar, the marketing around the calendar, you know, traveling to exotic destinations. If you see our digital films that have promoted the calendar this year, it's all about traveling to exotic destinations, whether it's a Croatia, whether it's you know, Cebu or South Africa or wherever, or Greece, for instance, wherever we've shot the calendars. It's about the culture there, it's about the food there, it's about the travel. In fact, we have the models also going around town, shopping, eating at restaurants, speaking the local language. It's more a travelogue kind of thing.
Which is fine, but the final product has a lot of skin to it, right?
It does, and I just feel that it's really classy, really sort of sophisticated, and not done in a sleazy downmarket manner. And it's
but only left to you. Would you want to continue it the way it is, or would you want to bring about a little bit of change?
See, the reality that it has done a lot for us from a glamour and style quotient point of view, and this has been researched.
But do you think somewhere or the other it affects a mindset? While you are what you are trying to tell me, it affects a mindset that our children are going to inherit this world that we leave behind for them. And if a woman's body is associated with an alcoholic beverage, I'm not sure that's the finest thing that we would want to, you know, leave back.
You know, you're trying to trap me in this, etc. The reality is, it's probably our smallest initiative, and there's a legacy reason for it, really, nothing else. I mean, what we do with IPL, what we do with Formula One, what we do with Kingfisher East Bengal football, and now with ISL, with the Bangalore Football Club, Goa Football Club, like I said, Kingfisher East Bengal, the racing, the derbies, music festivals, food, etc. The calendar is like a really, really small part of what we do.
And the rest of it doesn't have any objectification for women.
I don't think the calendar has objectification either. You know, I think it's just done in a really... Because by that logic, we've been part of fashion shows. We used to do fashion, and you know, you have women walking the ramp, etc. One could perhaps make a comment for that as well.
You know, it's just so that we're all so embroiled in this. I remember Nikhil Advani, who's a director in movies, and he actually, through one of the conferences, said that given the kind of situation that we're literally seeing in the country today, I vouch to say I'm not going to encourage any item numbers in my movies anymore. While they're very popular in terms of culture, we see our kids, you know, gyrating literally on the kind of songs that are there. But then from a larger perspective, it's not a great...
I think that's a great observation. You see, now while there is also the rise of the right wing across the world, there is also a rise of political correctness and political consciousness. Millennials today want to buy and brands, products and services, and be associated with goods and brands that stand for a higher purpose other than just making money.
Irrespective of whatever the past has been, there have been mistakes which have been made primarily for whatever reasons they may. It doesn't hurt a brand to stand up and say, okay, we're not going to follow what we were following at a particular time, like how that director said that while it would help in the sales of the movie, but now moving forward, it's a conscious decision that we will not take.
That's right. You know, the only thing, I think India has not evolved to the extent where brands and people can stand up and say, I'm sorry, I apologize, I made a mistake, I will come back and do better. And it's funny because we see that in sports. I think sportsmen have the greatest attitude towards winning and losing. Sometimes as an audience, and I've been a sportsman myself, as an audience you feel this person is not impacted by his or her loss at all. That's not true. It's just that they've been taught professionally how to deal with it and move on and come back and try and win the next day. Everything also has to change. It cannot remain the way it was in the previous generation. I mean, today, daughters and mothers are best friends. I mean, they go shopping together. I mean, my wife and daughter sometimes wear each other's clothes. You know,
daughter and I all the time.
I see that as well. So today, mothers-in-law and daughters-in-law are best friends.
If I were categorically to ask you to compare your relationship with your dad and yours with your child, how would that matter?
I think my relationship with my father was very formal.
It's interesting when I say dad and you say relationship with my father was very formal.
Yeah, so I can't call him, even though I call him Pitaji, but you know, when I say my father, I don't say my dad. Whereas my daughter calls me dad, papa, pops, papi, anything. My father's relationship with me was very formal and he was very English, and his relationship with his father was even more formal. I think it's still a little formal, but you know, you just can't bring up your children that way today. I tried to be the kind of father that I would have wanted to have had.
Right.
And therefore my relationship with my daughter is extremely close, extremely open. There is no topic under the sun that is taboo.
Including periods, including everything. Yeah.
Like I said, no topic that is taboo. And I'm so happy that she sort of will talk to me about anything, because the way I interpret it, that she has faith and trust and confidence
Correct.
In me.
The communication channels are
That's
open.
Right. And I would rather she have the conversation with us, with me and my wife, rather than from a stranger, than the stranger, you know, and now that she lives at the other end of the world.
Such a bright young girl pursuing music.
Thank you.
In one of the finest music schools in the world.
Thank you. In Hindi, the saying, Pehla Sukh Nirogi Kaya, Duja Sukh Paas Me Ho Maya, which means the first health, the first happiness is a healthy body.
And Maya is that lady?
Maya means money.
And I love the way Shahabat sounds.
You know, I'd like people to believe that that Samar was a great guy. He made a difference. He helped us when we needed help. He taught us a few things. He was approachable. He was honest. He was open. And he enriched our lives.
And maybe changed slightly the Kingfisher calendar as well.
I'll take you up on that one.
Thank you so much,
Thank you,
for doing this for me.
All the very best. Thank you.